Hello and welcome to a special interview for The Wire, supported by Glenlivet Books. Is love jihad a myth and concoction, or is it a fact? And secondly, does the government have a right to decide who can change their religion and convert, and who cannot? Those are two key issues I shall raise today with the former editor of The Organizer, a member of the National Executive of the Bharatiya Janata Party, Seshadri Chari. Mr. Chari, let me start with a straightforward question. Do you believe young Muslims have launched upon a love jihad to convert Hindu girls by marrying them?
Look, Karan, let me try and answer your question with a little bit of sincerity. You know, it's a very complex issue. Firstly, I mean, there is a lot of, there is a total lack of academic and public policy on this issue. There is also the question of credibility. You know, there are some terms that come and occupy the public narrative discussions and debates, which may not really be a dictionary word. For example, pseudo-secular. The word came up, it stuck, people believed. And who can explain pseudo-secular? Nobody can explain the words, but these two words juxtaposed meant a lot of things. They conveyed what the situation wanted to be conveyed. And remember, the word pseudo-secular was coined by someone like Dr. L.K. Advani.
Yes, sir.
In 2014.
Mr. Jari, let's not get stuck on pseudo-secular, come back to love jihad. Do you?
No. I'll come to that. I'm coming to love jihad. See, you know, in 2014, the word that was very popular was policy paralysis. Now, can the common man really give a lecture on policy paralysis? He can't, but he understood the term. I think there is a similar sentiment as far as love jihad is concerned. You know, if you explain, love and jihad are two very absolutely different words. They don't go together at all. But when they are juxtaposed and used in a particular context, people tend to believe. And mind you, this love jihad, the word, it has been used by the CPM. Achyutanandan, the former CPM chief minister of Kerala, used this word in a press conference. The Kerala Bishops' Conference has used this word not only in a press conference, but in their meetings.
Mr. Chari, I have to interrupt you. I can understand what you're saying when you say people understand the term, and you went on to say people tend to believe it. But I'm asking you to tell me what you believe. Do you believe that young Muslim men are deliberately marrying Hindu girls to convert them? Tell me, do you believe that or not?
You know, you cannot say that it's absolutely wrong to say that young Muslim men are not marrying Hindu women. Again, I'll have to go back to what the Kerala Bishops' Conference said. The Kerala Bishops' Conference said that we have recorded more than 4,500 cases of Muslim men marrying Christian girls. Now, this is Kerala Bishops' Conference saying it. Now, whether there is truth in it or not, what we have to do is we will have to go into a clinical examination of the situation, and going by what is generally believed, there is a problem. Do we have to wait till the problem becomes a pandemic? Do we have to recognize the problem?
Mr. Chari, I want to quote to you what G. Kishan Reddy, the Minister of State for Home, said officially in the Lok Sabha on the 5th of February, just 11 months ago. He said, no such case of love jihad has been reported by any of the central agencies. That is such an important sentence, I'm going to repeat it again. No such case of love jihad has been reported by any of the central agencies. That clearly means that love jihad is a myth, it's a concoction, it's not a fact.
No, here, Karan, when the minister says something on the floor of the house, we have to find out what was the framework of the inquiry. Did they have any framework of the inquiry as far as love jihad is concerned? They must have told the police to go and find out something. The police said there is nothing as far as, I mean, we don't know what is love jihad. They can only say that, yes, so-and-so married so-and-so person. But beyond that, they cannot go and prove. So we have to define these terms.
Forgive me.
If you have to take the minister's words into...
I'm interrupting you again. The minister was answering a specific question. Is there a campaign by young Muslim men to marry Hindu girls to convert them to Islam? That's what he was answering. That's what he meant by the term love jihad. So it's not a question of frames of inquiry. He knew what he was addressing. He gave a crystal clear answer. Now, there is only two outcomes that are possible from the minister's answer. Either the minister doesn't know what he's talking about, or the minister is lying. There is no third possibility.
It's not the question of whether minister is right or wrong, or whether he was lying, or whether he was just giving a report that was handed over to him by the police department or by the CBI. So what we have to see is two things. One, is there a framework? Does the law have a framework? When the minister was speaking like this, did he have any framework under which this investigation was done? On what basis the investigation was done? And on the basis of that investigation, do you think that CPM was wrong in saying that there is love jihad? Achyutanandan was wrong in saying that there is love jihad? Catholic Bishop Council was wrong in saying that 4,500 Christian girls have been converted? They are all wrong and only the CBA is right.
No, hang on. They're all wrong and only the minister is right. We're talking of a minister.
I'm not talking about the minister.
G. Kishan,
no, tomorrow.
Are you saying tomorrow the minister is wrong? That's what you're implying. Are you saying it? Say it up front.
No. Karan, just look at it. Tomorrow, if there is a framework to find out whether love jihad cases have taken place or not, and if the CBI goes ahead and says that yes, there are cases of love jihad, and then the minister comes on record saying that, yes, I said that there was no record as far as CBI is concerned. Now the CBI has come out with the record. So I think these are all circumstantial.
You're sketching an imaginary situation. The CBI hasn't come on record to say there are cases of love jihad.
But what was the framework? What was the framework under which?
Mr. Chari, let me carry on. I have a second minister from the BJP who has also made claims which his own government has disproved. Siddharth Nath Singh, a minister in the UP government of Yogi Adityanath, has gone on record to say more than 100 cases of forcible conversion have taken place. His government, no one else, his government appointed a special investigation team to look into the matter, and they ruled out any conspiracy angle in the cases it investigated. And they also found no evidence that Muslim youths are involved in any funding from abroad. And I can quote the Inspector General of Police if you want. I don't want to burden you with more information than you need. But here's a second instance of a BJP minister, this time in UP, claiming there is love jihad, and his own government's investigation team saying, sorry, we found no evidence.
You know, again, I'm telling you, Siddharth Nath Singh is a responsible person. I know him personally very well. Now, when he has said that there are more than 100 cases involving love jihad, he should substantiate his claim. On the other hand, when you say the SAT has given out a report, now look, if you think that 14 cases are enough, investigating just 14 cases, and on the basis of these 14 cases, if you have to come to a conclusion, and if you think that the UP police has done a wonderful job, it is one of the best police force in the whole world, then I leave it to you. It's for you to believe.
Mr. Chari,
let me add.
Mr. Chari, you have managed to cast aspersions on the UP police brilliantly, and you've done it for the
support of
the case.
Let me tell you one more thing about this. One more thing, if I am not wrong, I have not gone through the entire report of this. I don't have the original copy of that report. But I have gone through some of the newspaper reports, and these newspaper reports are not my paper, my former paper organizer. I'm telling you mainstream newspapers. They say that out of these 14 cases, I think the Inspector General of Kanpur, Mr. Mohit Agarwal, is quoted as saying that 11 out of the 14 cases were found to be criminal elements, and 11 persons have been sent to jail.
Forgive me, sir.
You are also said, right.
Forgive me, sir. First of all, criminal elements does not mean love jihad. It means criminal elements, people who've indulged in other crimes. And secondly,
correct. Correct.
FIR is filed. Not one FIR. Not even other criminal crimes. Leave aside the love jihad. That's also clear. But you said an important thing. I want to repeat it. You said,
No.
Most is hard thing. And you said he should substantiate his claim. In other words, the onus is on Siddharth Nath Singh. If he claims there are 100 cases, substantiated, name them, identify them, give us proof. He hasn't done it.
He will have to do it. If you believe that, he will have to do it. But he will have to do it under some framework of law. As of now, there is no framework as far as these are concerned. Again, pardon me for going back to the report of SIT. Let me tell you that the same report the person who wrote the report, General Inspector General of Kanpur, Mohit Agarwal, he has also said that in all these 14 cases, in 3 cases, the boys concealed their identity, their names, and tried to influence the girls with false names. And later on, the girls found that these boys were not Hindus, they were some other religion. Therefore,
Mr. Chari, neither you nor I are bachelors, neither you nor I claim innocence. Boys frequently assume fraudulent names to entrap a girl. That's not love jihad. That's lust. That's sexual encounter. No. That's the way we behave. You may be an angel. But most men are not when it comes to women, and such ploys, much as they may be.
You cannot generalize, Karan. You cannot say that every case of a boy falling in love with a girl ends up in a misrepresented name or misrepresented identity. You cannot say that. You cannot generalize. It should be one in a million, one in a lakh, if not one in thousands or hundreds.
Let's.
I don't know, Karan. If you did it, I can understand. I don't know whether you did it.
Not only me. Loads of boys, and I admit I did it. Loads of us try when we're young, different boys, to get a girl's attention, to hold a hand, to sneak a kiss.
That's human nature.
It's not love.
No.
Christians do it. Jains do it. Sikhs do it.
Trying to attract the attention is different, but concealing one's identity, concealing one's name, concealing one's religion, and not 1, 2, 3, 4, but when it comes to hundreds of cases, there is a problem. Karan, don't go by the word. No. If you have an objection to the word love jihad, call it something else. But try to understand. What I'm trying to say is, there is a problem. There is a social problem.
Stop a moment. Let's approach this a different way. Explain this to me. If a young Muslim boy whose entire future lies ahead of him marries a Hindu girl simply to convert her to Islam, is he mad? Because then he's stuck with her for the rest of his life. Why on earth would a young Muslim boy do that? Why would he sacrifice his life to convert an unknown Hindu girl to Islam? Because then he's stuck with that woman as his wife for the rest of his life. Explain why anyone would do that.
I'm not a trained psychologist to go into the details of why a Muslim boy should do these things. I mean, I don't try and get into the whole this ghettoism of Muslim boys and Christian boys and Christian girls and Muslim girls. You know, if you say there are people in every community, especially very unfortunately, when I'm saying what I'm going to say now, I'm saying with a lot of authority, but with lot of pain, I am saying this, with lot of pain, let me tell you, there have been some kind of an indoctrination, years and years of indoctrination that perhaps has gone into minds of people. Young minds can be easily polluted. Young minds can be easily influenced. So when you have a continuous uncritical indoctrination running into so many places, so many years, and there could be also some kind of a monetary financial reward attached to all
explain
these.
Explain what indoctrination you are speaking about, Mr. Chari. Who is indoctrinated and by whom? Please explain it. Are you saying Hindus are indoctrinated to believe the worst of Muslims?
No. I am telling you, when you asked a specific question about Muslim boys, I am telling you there could be a section of these Muslim boys who are getting indoctrinated.
On what basis do you say this?
Sarji.
Hang on.
No, that is what I am saying.
Mr. Chari, no. On what basis are you leveling this vile accusation? Is it just your prejudice?
No, I am not. I'm not making an accusation. I'm making an observation.
You asked me specifically,
why should a Muslim boy ever do this? And if a Muslim boy is doing it, one possible psychological reason could be the continuous indoctrination that he is exposed to. A. B. There could also be a financial angle to this. So I'm just suggesting that these could be the reasons. You asked me a question, why Muslim boy should do it? I mean, and remember one thing, as a Muslim boy, if he marries a Hindu girl, okay, he is allowed to, it's wrong to say that he will be stuck with that girl forever.
Let me stop you. I think it's fair that I should point out to the audience that what you are saying is pure supposition on your part. I'm repeating it. Pure supposition on your part when you claim that there could be continuous indoctrination, and secondly, when you claim there could be financial angles to it. By the way, Mohit Agarwal, who you were citing a moment ago, has categorically said that they were not being funded from abroad. Categorically. He's also said categorically that they did not find any organization to be behind the youth. Those are Mr. Agarwal's words, which I'm repeating. But let me put something else to you. It's not just that this theory of love jihad assumes that a young Muslim boy is prepared to sacrifice his entire life to marry an unknown Hindu girl and convert her to Islam, something that I find bizarre and very difficult to believe.
No.
This theory of love jihad... let me finish. This theory of love jihad also presupposes that young Hindu girls are fools. And I use that word advisedly. You're presupposing that they're helpless, that they're naive, and most importantly of all, that they cannot recognize the difference between true love and fake love. That they are so foolish, and I'm deliberately using that word, that they fall into a trap. And if it's happening in the hundreds and thousands, as you claim, then that means there are hundreds and thousands of Hindu girls who are foolish enough, and I'm repeating that word deliberately, foolish enough to fall into this trap. What image are you creating of Hindu girls by believing in love jihad?
No, I am not extending. See, we are again going into the idea of generalization. When you say why Muslim boys, you are generalizing each and every Muslim boy in this country. Don't generalize.
Come to Hindu girls.
Hindu girls
naive and foolish to not be able to distinguish between real love and pretense love and to form
you will have to reframe Karan, you will have to reframe that question. We are talking only about these girls who are victims in this case. We are only talking about victims. We are not even talking about those girls who are having a happy married life.
Mr. Chari,
we wish them all the best.
You're being clever.
No, we cannot generalize.
You're being clever in calling these Hindu girls victims because that suggests that they've somehow been preyed upon. The truth is, love jihad only works if the girl falls in love with a boy who's not really in love with her. So she's falling in love. She's falling into the trap. And she falls into the trap because she cannot distinguish between true love and fake love. And that means she's naive. It also suggests she's foolish. And this is why I ask, the image that your theory of love jihad conveys of Hindu girls is that they're fools, that they don't know the difference between true love and fake love.
No, you are extending these cases to the entire society. Just like you said that why Muslim boys would do this. When you say why Muslim boys would do this, don't assume that each and every Muslim boy is in this country is doing this.
Hindu girls?
Don't generalize.
Back to Hindu girls. But answer my question. Why are Hindu girls in their hundreds or thousands? By the way, Siddharth Nath Singh says it's hundreds. You seem to suggest it could be thousands. Why are they falling in love with Muslim boys when the Muslim boy is only luring and entrapping them? Are they fools? Are they naive? Do they not know the difference between true love and fake love?
Therefore, this is the whole crux of the problem lies here. It's not that they are fools, but if they have been enticed, if they have been coerced, if they have been fooled, if they have been led to believe some things, is it their fault? Yes, it is their fault because they say one has to believe.
They have been fooled, right? Obviously, they have been, and only naive people get fooled in matters of love. And the image you are suggesting by propounding the theory of love jihad is that Indian women are naive and foolish. That's what I'm pointing out.
No, I didn't say that. I didn't say that. Karan, you are saying it. Karan, I am trying to tell you the same thing. Karan, I am trying to tell you that. Don't generalize. Don't say all Hindu women are fools. No, I never said that. You said it.
Mr. Chari,
don't generalize.
Mr. Chari, not for a moment am I saying all Hindu women are fools. Not for a moment am I suggesting all Muslim boys are either.
Reframe your question.
Your understanding, sir. It's your understanding. I'm simply saying that love jihad as a theory implies that those boys who do it are prepared to sacrifice their life to convert an unknown Hindu girl to Islam and then get landed with her for the rest of their life. That's bizarre and inexplicable. And secondly, love jihad also assumes that the girls who fall into the trap are naive and foolish and can't distinguish between real love and fake love. Of those people involved in love jihad, this has to be true if your theory holds. Otherwise, your theory is wrong, and I'm sure it is.
No, it's not the question of trying to prove somebody's theory. The question is not the question here is not theory. The question is there are certain factual information that is available. So we have to critically examine these cases. Okay. We have to see why these cases have taken place. Is there an indoctrination behind this? Is there a monetary issue behind this? Are these girls really naive? What are the issues?
Mr. Chari, we're repeating ourselves. Let's not do that. You claim that there is factual information behind this. It's factual information that the Minister of State for Home and Parliament is utterly unaware of. Our central agencies, as he said, are utterly unaware of. You may be aware of it. Siddharth Nath Singh may be aware of it. But I'm pointing out that Mr. Modi's Minister of State for Home is not aware of it. But let's leave this part of the discussion aside. We've been through it thoroughly. We've aired our views. The audience have heard both sides. They can decide for themselves. Let me come to a second aspect that is a direct result of Yogi Adityanath's belief that love jihad is a fact. And this viewpoint is shared by several other BJP chief ministers because they'll be passing similar laws soon in Haryana, in Madhya Pradesh, possibly in Karnataka. I want to raise with you the ordinance recently passed by the UP government. It stipulates that anyone who wants to change their religion has to inform the government 2 months in advance, subject themselves to a police inquiry, and the government will invite, by the way, objections from the public. I put it to you that this is an abominable violation of the rights of citizens. How can you possibly justify this monstrous law?
No, Why monstrous? I mean, I'm telling you again and again, this is an issue. This is a social issue. And we will have to tackle this problem before it becomes a pandemic. Why do you want to brush it aside?
No.
So I tell you, this ordinance is good in a way. And this ordinance is the most secular document. Believe
no.
me. You go through the entire ordinance. It gives you two months time. No. Now, if a girl and a boy really want to get married.
Mr. Chari, you began your answer by asking me why have I used the word monstrous. Mm-hmm. Let me explain. Every single human being has a right to change their religion when they want, whenever they want, for whatever reason they want, and as often as they want. It is purely a matter between the individual and his or her God. How dare, and I repeat that word, how dare any government seek to intervene? And yet that is precisely what Yogi Adityanath is doing. He's demanding 2 months advance notice. Who is he to demand it? He's saying that he will have a police inquiry as if changing your religion is a criminal matter. And then he's going to invite public objections as if this is something to do with the whole community. It's an individual and his God that this concerns. And so I repeat my question, how dare Yogi Adityanath pass this law?
Look at this. Now consider one case. In 2002, the then Tamil Nadu Chief Minister, Jayalalitha was in chair, Tamil Nadu passed the Tamil Nadu Prohibition of Forcible Conversion Act. Now, if you are very correct, everyone has a right to pursue a particular religion. Correct. Pursuing a religion is a fundamental right. And converting into some other religion and following some other religion is also your fundamental right. But conversion is not a fundamental right. Proselytization is not a fundamental right. Preaching a religion is a fundamental right, but conversion is not a fundamental right. And this is what the Tamil Nadu government at that time thought of. And they
very well did it. Mr. Chari, are you forgetting that 4 years later, or even less, 3 years later, she revoked that law? Have you forgotten that? She passed the law and she revoked it. You've forgotten that. I'm sorry, you've forgotten she revoked the law 3 years later. I assure you she did. Check up after the interview. She revoked the law. So let's leave Jayalalitha out of it. She changed her mind, revoked
Madhya
the
Pradesh. Come to that.
Madhya Pradesh. How do you justify?
No, I'll come to your question.
Come back. Let me repeat the question. How do you justify in a democracy, not in a dictatorship, in a democracy, a government saying, you have to give me 2 months advance notice before you change your religion? A government saying that we will hold a police inquiry as if you're some sort of a low-life criminal? A government saying that we will invite public objections as if this is a matter to do with the community? How do you justify it? This is why I say it's an abominable violation. It's a monstrous law. It makes a complete mockery of fundamental rights.
Not at all. Karan, go through the ordinance once again. Go through the ordinance word by word, clause by clause. Go through it. If it is ultra virus to the constitution, you can go to court. Anybody can go to court and it can be struck down. But I tell you,
this is
a secular law. It does not prohibit. No, but okay. Listen. Please let me complete. The law does not prohibit anybody from conversion. The law does not prohibit anybody from changing the religion. The law is not against the fundamental right of a person to pursue a particular religion at all. It only says you give a notice of 2 months.
Mr. Chari, I'm not a fool.
You can't wait for 2 months.
What the law is doing is to put impediments, to put barriers, to put restraints. And that in itself is wrong. It's morally wrong. It may not be legally wrong, but it is exerting the powers of the government beyond the capacity of the government to do so. It is reprehensible. Who are you to tell me I should give the government advance notice? Who are they to demand it? And then a police inquiry, and then public.
Karan, if you have to wait for 6 months, if you have to wait for 6 months, if you have to wait for 6 months to get a divorce, you cannot wait for 2 months to get married.
Just a moment.
What are you
talking? No, no. Just
what
a moment.
What are you talking about?
No
law says you cannot marry.
Not chalk and cheese. They're not the same. The reason you wait for 6 months to get a divorce is to make sure that the two parties want to divorce, which is why a divorce also has two stages, so that every chance is given to the estranged couple to see whether in fact that differences can be overcome without the marriage being ended. It's a different reason altogether. Here, an individual has decided a matter that affects no one else. Remember that, no one else. A divorce affects two people.
No. Don't say it affects no one else. No. Karan. You are absolutely wrong there. You are very wrong. Don't say that a change of religion does not affect anybody. It affects the family, it affects the parents, it affects the brothers, it affects the siblings, it affects the person, the boy and the girl also.
Under our constitution, you have a right to change your religion, and the fact that your parents, your siblings, your grandparents, the neighbors may not like it is irrelevant. It is irrelevant. You cannot impose their concerns.
No. You cannot say it is irrelevant.
It's totally irrelevant.
You cannot say it is irrelevant.
Totally irrelevant.
You can say, no, it is not irrelevant. Not at all, Karan. If you think in terms of the person, if you think in terms of the family, if you think in terms of so many psychological effects.
You know what you're doing? You're saying
you are missing a point.
Sorry, what you're doing is to say the individual is less important than the community, than the family, than the surroundings. That is turning up.
They are all important, very equally important. That is why the law says two months.
No, our constitution fundamentally recognizes rights as things that pertain to individuals. At some levels, no doubt they pertain to communities as well. But in this instance, under our constitution, the right of the individual takes precedence over siblings, parents, grandparents, family, community. But you're seeing it differently. Let's move at this point to a third stage. Once again, we've discussed this issue very adequately. The audience can form their own opinion. I want to now come back and tackle this issue of love jihad slightly differently. I put it to you, Mr. Chari, that a man or woman's willingness to give up their religion and take up another religion to marry the person they love is the highest expression of love. Changing your religion to marry someone who you love is the highest expression of love. Does your government, your party not understand that? Do you not understand love?
Highest expression of love, making bed coffee for your girlfriend or your wife is also highest expression of love. So you cannot quantify what is the highest expression of love. I mean, buying a piece of chocolate for her is also something as great as getting into her religion. And also, let me tell you, if there is true love, pursuing one's own religion, pursuing one's own traditions, pursuing one's own vocation, remaining independent as far as religious matters and matters of spirituality are concerned, allowing your wife to pursue her faith is also love.
But Mr. Chari, if the wife wishes to change her faith out of love for her husband or vice versa, that is an act.
It can happen.
That is an act that symbolizes the depth of devotion and love. And by the way, you did a very strange thing. You compared changing your religion to buying someone chocolate. If the two are really comparable, why is your party making such a fuss about changing religion? Your comparison is not my, the game away.
It's not the question of my party. It's there has to be a legal format. There has to be a framework.
No, sorry. This is,
that's all we are saying. And mind you, the law does not speak a word about Muslim.
No longer are we talking about love jihad in terms of law. We've done that earlier. Don't collapse back into it. We're now talking about love jihad, or what you call love jihad, and the changing of religion as an expression of love. You don't believe that the willingness of a man or woman to give up their religion and embrace the religion of the person they love is the highest expression of love. You mock that. So let me give you a personal example. 31 years ago, I married a Goan Catholic, Nisha. She had been brought up from her childhood to think of marriage as a marriage in church. But when she fell in love with a Hindu, that became impossible. However, Father Terry in England, one of the most enlightened Scottish priests I've ever met, said he didn't, forgive my language, he said he didn't give a damn whether Karan was a Hindu or an alien. If Nisha wanted a full church service for her wedding, she would have it. But, and this is the point I want to make, but if Father Terry had not been so broad-minded, I would have willingly given up my religion and become a Catholic so my wife's dream of a wedding in church could be fulfilled. And let me tell you something else. My Hindu gods would not have been offended. They would have immediately recognized Jesus and Mary as incarnations of themselves. And more importantly, my gods would have said, love to your wife is the best way of loving your God. But your party doesn't seem to understand that. Your party doesn't understand love. It doesn't understand how people in love are happy to change their religion. You just don't understand that.
Karan, I appreciate your personal example. I can give you at least 24 personal examples. I can give you, but I don't have the permission of the person concerned to give those examples. But I can, it is suffice to say that these examples actually prove the point that I am trying to make. The point that I am trying to make is loving, falling in love and living a married life and loving your wife or your husband, as the case may be, and tolerating her faith or his faith. You can, it could be the other way around also, Karan. It could be the other way around also.
I agree.
A Christian boy falling in love with a Hindu girl.
I agree.
A Muslim boy. Listen, Karan, please. Karan, you have asked a question. Let me complete. I'm just trying to complete one sentence. I'm just saying, whether a Muslim boy marries a Hindu girl or a Hindu boy marries a Muslim girl, if there is true love between them, let them go through the legal process. Let them go through the fundamental elements of the law of the society and also go by these processes. And if they are able to understand each other, there is absolutely no problem. I'm telling you, neither Congress, nor Communist, nor BJP has any political right.
Let me interrupt at this point.
We are only looking at problems.
I agree with what you're saying. You say that respect for the individual also means that you're happy for the individual to retain her or his religion and you still get married. It works both ways. Okay. Just as respect requires accepting the other has a different religion, love could also mean that you give up your religion because you want to be part of the same faith. The logic works both ways.
Let me finish.
I am prepared to accept the logic works both ways. Your party, your government won't accept that it works in terms of love leading to religion being given up. That way, you don't accept. Only the other way you do. You accept half of this equation, not the second half. That's the problem.
No. Where does the law say this? Have you read the ordinance?
We're talking of emotion. We're talking.
Have you read the ordinance?
Ethics. We're no longer on law. We've moved beyond law. Let me end this interview by putting one more thing to you. India, as you know, is a heterogeneous country. We have a perplexing plethora of castes, creeds, cultures, cuisines, complexions. I put it to you, Perhaps the only way we can become one is through intermarriage. It's in the interest of the country that you encourage intermarriage rather than erect barriers and try and make it difficult. You're doing the opposite of what India really needs.
It's a good idea, and this is not the only idea. Allowing interreligious marriage is not the only criteria for a heterogeneous society, for a pluralistic lifestyle. If you want to really encourage this, you will have to have some sort of a framework where you are only trying to minimize the problems that could come out. And these things take a long time.
But Mr. Chari, 100
years, 50 Mr. years. Chari, I think it is better to be careful rather than allow things to take a different kind of a course.
Mr. Chari,
I support your idea.
Mr. Chari, you may say, but think about what your government and party are doing. You're not minimizing the problems. That was the phrase you used. You're maximizing them. You're creating problems when obstacles when none exist. You're creating onerous requirements that violate the rights of Indians as citizens. That's what you're doing.
There is no violation. There is no violation of anyone's rights. This is only trying to be a little more careful and bringing all these relationships within the framework of law so that either it is a boy or a girl, whether Christian, Hindu or Muslim, his religious rights are taken care of.
Once
that
again,
is the whole idea.
I disagree with what you're saying. You're not bringing the situation within the framework of law. You're creating new law to actually make the situation difficult. The law exists. The constitution exists. Under the constitution, you can convert. Under the constitution, you can marry who you want. You're creating a new framework whereby problems occur and a whole lot of procedures are required, which I say violate the fundamental rights. But let's again leave that there. Let me come to my very last question. The Western world is convinced that in many ways, but we'll stick to this love jihad issue, your party and your government are infringing on the democratic, moral, fundamental rights of Indian people. More importantly, the Western world is convinced that you're stigmatizing Muslims in particular. And now that it's almost certain that Antony Blinken will be the next Secretary of State in America, it's also certain that the incoming Biden administration will be asking awkward questions about love jihad, about the treatment of Muslims in India. And if your government and your party sticks by its stand, you're going to end up embarrassing India. Does it not worry you? You're going to convey to people abroad that this country with a proud 5,000-year civilization is fast becoming medieval, uncivilized, and just a few steps short of barbaric. That's what you're going to convince people. Does it worry you?
Successive governments in this country have handled these problems as far as India's image outside is concerned very well. Be it BJP, be it Congress, be it any government, they have done it very well. And the present government will also do very well. What is more important is to tackle the domestic problems. USA has got its own problems of racial discrimination. China has got its own problems of Uyghur Muslims. And China has got problems of human rights violations in Tibet. There are innumerable problems as far as the Western world is concerned. We don't have to worry about those problems. We have to try and resolve the domestic problems. That is more important.
All right.
As far as the present dispensation is concerned, they are more than capable of tackling these kinds of issues. Believe me.
Quite right, Mr. Chari. They may well be more than capable of tackling these issues. The concern is how they tackle them and whether the outcome is desirable or deeply regrettable. But that's another story. I'm not beginning the interview again. I want to thank you for having agreed to this interview. I want to point out that you are a very rare member of the BJP who's prepared to tackle a subject that most people are happy to pronounce about ex cathedra, but not respond to when questioned. You were willing, and I applaud you for this
no, you
agreement of your heart. to answer all my questions. Take care. Stay safe.